Last time on MeatEater, I flew into the Alaska range with my brother Danny and our friend Paul Neese, where we tagged out early on a nice Dall ram.
Oh my God.
It's got a lot of growth rings and full curl.
Yeah, that's nice.
Now we're headed back down to our base camp, where we're gonna hang this sheep in a tree and then head out for bears.
You know something's up. Oh, there he goes.
I'm Steven Rinella. To me, hunting isn't only about the pursuit of an animal. It's about who we are and what we're made of. I live to hunt and hunt to live. I am a meat eater. I'm midway through a hunt in the Alaska range of central Alaska. I'm here because I managed to pull a long shot lottery draw for a Dall sheep tag in the famed Tok Management Area, a bit of luck that has eluded many hunters who spent 30 years applying. With me is my buddy Paul Neese from Vortex Optics, who dreams of drawing his own Tok tag, and my brother Danny, who's an Alaskan, which means I can legally hunt sheep without having to hire a registered guide. On the first day of the season, we were lucky to get after a legal ram and then tag out within the day. Now we're headed back down to the base of the mountain to hang this meat. The weather is cool enough that it'll be fine for a day or so, but that's about it. Just enough time for a mad dash bear hunt. If we can find one, the memories from this trip will be all the more pleasurable.
If you look up from here to that one visible snow patch up on that mountain, that's where we killed that ram a couple days ago. And now we're heading out looking for bears. Paul has a black bear tag. I have a grizzly tag. There's both in this area. We've been seeing a lot of sign. Some older sign from grizzlies down in this bottom, and then a lot of bear crap up around that area where the spruce goes into the alder, and then the alder starts going into the more tundry alpine stuff where the berries are thick. That's what we're looking for, but the problem is you're gonna lose sight of that bear for a long time if you go after it, because you're gonna be in thick stuff, head high, can't see 10 feet in front of you. It's gonna be tough. This is not a place that I would pick if I was specifically gonna come out and hunt bear because of that reason, but we should probably be able to make something happen.
Our plan is to head upstream, concentrating our glassing efforts on the narrow band of vegetation that lies on the mountainsides between the thick spruce and the open tundra. That's where the greatest abundance of blueberries can be found, and that's where the bears are going to be. We don't want to commit to any climbs until we find what we're after. That is, an adult-sized bear, black or grizzly, with no cubs.
Here's some bear sign.
Digging, quite a bit more digging right up here, too. Just trying to dig the root out of there.
Yeah.
He found what he was looking for there.
You can see who he's after.
Like he snipped the root mass off.
Yeah, it's like he swiped that up and then bit off the root ball.
Took the root and left the plant. Yeah.
Everywhere we look in the river bottoms,
it's got a good taste.
We find evidence where grizzlies have been digging up Eskimo potato, one of their favorite root crops.
I mean, it tastes as good as eating raw potato.
It is. That's not bad at all.
I mean, if you went to the produce section and just started eating raw roots out of it, it's all gonna be about like that. Here's some bear sign.
It's interesting. You don't see many berries at all in there.
No, he's got a lot of that like just really fibrous root. See there? It's that same stuff.
They might eat that stuff before the berries are available.
Yeah, you wonder about that because they kind of have that tiered plant to plant. You know, they know what to look for at certain times and remember that, and they learn that stuff pretty well.
You know, we're here and we're hunting, but this is just a tough place to pull off a bear hunt. You just got that thick barrier of vegetation between you and wherever you're going to see the animals. There's just no easy way. It's not like just hunting them up in the alpine where you can go after them and find them again. I mean, when these boys go into that stuff, they're gone.
For hours, we wander the base and glassing everything we can with no luck. But then, finally.
Oh, black bear down low.
Really?
Oh yeah, nope. Look at that sucker.
It's a small black bear, Paul's tag.
But he's just traveling though.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, as quick as the bear emerged, he fed right back into the brush.
He's gone.
Let's keep an eye out for him, but you're not gonna catch him.
Let's just go see what he's got ahead of him.
We decide to split up in order to glass the mountain from different angles so we can try to relocate the bear.
That bear just vanished into a hellhole back there. We just got lucky and caught him. Oh, yep, there's that bear. He is feeding in there.
Gotta find Paul.
What's up?
He's up there feeding on the bottom edge of those rocks. It's not a big monster, but he's just dinking around down there.
We should probably let Paul have a look at him, decide if he wants to shoot it or not.
What are you guys thinking? You want to go back across?
Well,
and
Steve says he's small, and that he's down low in that rock pile, and Steve saw him from back there somewhere.
You can see into that slope really well from out here.
What I would do is just get in there, check the wind, and get up in that rock pile,
yeah,
and have Danny out here with a scope. It's not a bruiser.
Did you get a good look at him?
Not a good look, a good enough look to tell he's not a bruiser. But I mean, we could go out here and wait and take a good look at him, or go up there and get ready to shake hands with him, then see what he looks like.
Yeah, well, let's do that. Danny can stay out here, I'll come back with you, and you and I can go up there, try to get under him, get a good close look at him.
Just keep checking in with me and like assume that mountain is just, you know, a vertical plane, and this is straight up, and this is straight down, and this is sideways and diagonal up. And
I don't know what it would be, but if you see some reason to totally abort, just give the old, I don't know what that would be though.
If he wins you any bucks, I'll just.
Yeah.
We've got a small black bear feeding on blueberries up on the side of the mountain. It's a reachable bear, so Paul and I are headed for it while Danny remains down below as a spotter.
Last fix we got, this bear is riding the slope. The wind's down valley. Let's see what this wind winds up doing. The wind switches, we'll have to change our approach.
Hopefully there might be a spot when we clear the trees here, we can see them and still have a little bit of height.
Too bad these aren't better climbing trees.
You're good.
As we climb, we have to be extremely careful, stopping the glass every few minutes. We can't see the bear from this angle, and we're not high enough to see Danny yet. At this point, we don't know if he's right on top of us or totally gone. All this time, Paul and I have no idea where the bear is. We're just assuming that it's still in the area where we last saw it. Meanwhile, Danny can probably see us and the bear. It's gotta be frustrating to be in his position. He's probably thinking something like, left, you morons, left.
Hey, Steve, my guess is he's probably a little bit lower than, you know, that's why we're not seeing him up, yeah. I think he's just come down. Well, we got the wind on our side. If he don't smell us, I think we can get right in there on top of him. I think we can probably see right up through here.
Yeah, I'll follow you.
Thank you.
know something's up. You get ready to go. Oh, there he goes. Steve's got it.
Not a very huge bear, but good hit.
That was a good job, man.
Yeah.
For what we had to work with.
That's a pretty good day for just loading up, camping up, and hiking up river.
I'm telling you, man, the fact that we headed out this morning looking for a bear this close to the bottom.
Good spot, Danny.
I really wasn't sure if you guys would be able to see him or not.
Yeah,
I do.
That's when he saw him. He saw me about the same time.
I tell you though, man, in this area, to be like, let's go out and get a bear and get it like that afternoon, I was surprised.
Yeah.
I was not thinking that was going to happen.
It's been a long day and we're due for a good meal. The nice thing about hunting with two other guys is you're really able to multitask. So while Paul and Danny tackle skinning and butchering Paul's bear, I'm gonna see about cooking up a rack of ribs from the Dall sheep.
There's two guides who are kind of famous for, you know, famous among sheep hunters for guiding in the Tok region. There's a guy, Lance Kronberger, and a guy, Rick French. And when I got Lance on the phone, I asked him, I said, what's your favorite Dall sheep meal? Like, what's your favorite field prep for Dall sheep? He said he likes to build a little hut out of rocks, like a little structure, and build a fire inside there, and then use the rib rack as the roof of the house and just cook it like that, flipping it and let that fat drip down in the flame. So I'm gonna try that right now. Danny is highly incredulous that this is gonna work. He thinks that these ribs will be unchewable. Fit. What I want to do is lay a couple willows across it. Those would be like rafters that are going to hold my rib rack roof on top of the house here. She is. So far, the man who told me about this is right, because that fat's dripping, it's flaming. I'm slowly becoming a believer on this preparation. You might not want that much fat on a normal Sunday night after you've been sitting around all day long, but when you've been out hunting, you're burning tons of calories going up and down the mountains all the time. You get where you really have a desire for fatty foods, fattier than you want at home. And right now, from the perspective I'm coming at this from, I'm really looking at all this dripping fat, and I'm thinking this is looking perfect. Danny's gonna be proven wrong by these ribs, I think. Danny, I think you're gonna be proven wrong by these ribs, man. Now take your knife, just whittle a chunk like that. Look at that. Don't tell me that's too tough for you. That sheep continues to impress, man.
Oh, sorry. Pretty darn tasty.
Man. You like it?
It's not like fall off the bone tender, but it's edible. Yeah, it's pretty good.
For something that most guys don't even like to keep, it's good.
Yeah.
You gotta fight with it a little bit.
No, it's not bad. That's not bad.
Listen, I'm not sitting here pretending that these ribs are tender. If I was having people over, I would never be like, oh, I got an idea.
Yeah.
I'll throw a big rack of ribs on the grill and make them chew on it. But for being like really hungry and wishing you had some fatty something, it's a good way to go.
Here's this big cut of meat right here, and I'm a little afraid to tangle with it. I do it bit by bit.
Well, you're getting the knife involved in here, huh?
We're all packed up, just waiting on a plane. And now we're gonna kill some time cooking up a bear loin, asado style. I got turned on to this type of cooking while reporting a magazine story on the Argentine barbecue tradition. They call this cut entraña fina.
You're gonna lay that fat boy on there.
And while any Argentine asador would likely cringe at this particular setup, it does employ the method of keeping the meat well above the coals and giving it plenty of time to cook. One thing that I love about hunting is the anticipation that comes with knowing you've got a great trip coming up. For this trip, I spent about 7 months studying maps and daydreaming about these very days. In fact, the anticipation became almost like a friend, someone that was by my side. But now that this is almost over, I'm already starting to miss being able to look forward to it.
All right. Every time you bite into a bear, it's a little bit like, fingers crossed.
Pretty good, though.
You like it? Yeah, they always look good.
Kind of a tasty piece of meat.
You just gotta wonder, had he just come off finding some rotten moose rolling out of a riverbank, or was he eating blueberries?
You better do the first bite. So what was he eating, Steve?
He wasn't eating rotten moose rolling out of a riverbank. He's good. Nice and smoked.
Yeah, that smelled good when it was cooking.
Yeah, usually cooking them, man, you'll get a sense, like you'll smell the problem.
Danny don't like eating fresh off the carcass.
I don't.
He likes it better if it's been in his freezer for a while.
It's just so tough, man, until it has a chance to mellow out for a while.
Well, I do appreciate you guys coming out and helping out.
It was a great time. It's a heck of an experience. You didn't have to twist my arm too hard to get me to come along on this.
Only right you came along to see your tag get filled.
Well, I'm glad you invited me. You know, as rare as these tags are, I could go off a long time before you ever get a chance to come up here and hunt sheep. That's a pretty rare experience.
As much as I'll miss the anticipation that this trip created, I know that I'll always have a great time remembering it. And I'll keep hatching new plans that are worth looking forward to. In fact, that's a good strategy for life. Make yourself do a lot of things that you'll be happy to look back on. And make sure you've got plans for more of those things in the future.